What's happening, y'all? We're back. We just finished defining row echelon form. In this video, we're going to talk about reduced row echelon form. Remember, both of those technologies were designed to help us solve general linear systems problems. The way that we did this was apply a sequence of elementary matrices on the left-hand side. Those matrices were designed to transform to reduce A into special form. We saw that row echelon form had this really kind of special structure called the stair-step structure, where all zeros were on the bottom and then leading entries went to the right as we moved down in rows. We are next going to talk about reduced row echelon form. Before I did that though, I wanted to call attention to a very kind of special thing. If we go onto our standard search browser and just type in echelon definition, I wanted to maybe go to the first one. So this is Merriam-Webster, an arrangement of a body of troops within its units to somewhat left or right, like a series of steps, a formation of units or individuals resembling such an echelon, a flight formation on which each airplane at a certain elevation above or below to the right or left. And what is nice about this is you can actually get a image search. Check this out. These bikers are in echelon form. They kind of step backwards. These airplanes are in echelon form. They kind of fly in that stair-step process. And then there's some nice little demonstrations of echelon form for troop formation. The reason that I think that is really useful is that that's exactly what's happening here. We've got this kind of like stair-step echelon form. The reason we called it reduced is that in general, when we start with a modeling context, we're not going to have a bunch of zeros right under the leading entry. And so we actually have to reduce it to that form, and then the echelon is the stair-step. The thing that I want to say is when we have a column that it is a non-pivot column. In other words, the leading entry is not in that. What will end up happening is there is a linear dependence between these two columns. In other words, column 2 is linearly dependent on column 1. Here we see that column 4 is linearly dependent on columns 3 and 1, since the ones with stars are the ones that we're going to call linearly independent. And we'll see that as we move forward. The claim, though, is in row echelon form, although we've kind of identified what the linear dependence relationships are, it is not so easy to figure out exactly how linearly dependent columns relate to linearly independent columns. In order to make that much more algebraically easy, what we say is, instead of just requiring that our special form is row echelon, we reduce it to a either further structure that immediately allows us to tell how each column is dependent on the ones previously. That special structure is called reduced row echelon form. For a matrix to be in reduced row echelon form, we say that there are three conditions. First, we say that a matrix is in reduced row echelon form if and only if it starts in row echelon form. And then the additional assumptions on that matrix are going to be that the leading entries are all equal to 1. In row echelon form, they can be anything, non-zero. In reduced row echelon form, they have to be 1. And then in any column with a leading entry, all other entries are 0. Let's see what I mean by this. So recall that we saw that the upper triangular matrix with non-zero entries on the diagonal was in row echelon form, so that satisfies condition 1. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to turn every single individual leading entry into ones and then zero out the non-leading entries in that matrix. This is row echelon form. This is reduced row echelon form. Let's take a look at another structure. Here we started with row echelon form. Leading entries were in stair-step structure. Next thing we're going to do is turn all of those leading entries to 1, usually via dilation matrix, and then cancel out all non-leading entries in those columns. Everything in a column involving a leading entry is 0. And we'll see why that's super important in terms of pivoting and then figuring out how the long stair-step depends on the previous pivot positions. Last example that we saw, we had this row echelon form matrix. We're going to turn each of the leading entries to 1, probably via dilation, and then we're going to cancel out for each column that involves a leading entry all other entries must go to zero, and that's exactly what we've done here. We've turned all leading entries to one, and then all non-leading entries in that column go to zero. So there's only a single non-zero in each of those columns that involves a leading entry. Let's go ahead and see some examples of how to generate linear systems from real-world modeling problems that actually exist in the space around you. And then in lesson 18, we'll see how to use these structures in order to solve general linear systems problems. See you in the next video.